Eric Bryant.
Good morning.
Morning. Morning.
It begins with hello. You meet some special someone. There's something that resonates with you. It seems as if there is an understanding that exists between the two of you. What seems at times an improbable meeting, and at other times something that was meant as destiny, it brings the two of you together. It leads to meetings. It leads to conversation. It leads to times of getting to know each other. And it can ultimately lead to forming a covenant relationship. Love is something rich. There's human love, and there is divine love. Divine love, as one author said, it begins with conversation, it continues with communion, and it ultimately ends with consummation. We may not be quite comfortable in thinking about our walk with God with those terms. But indeed, the songs that we've sung today, it talks about this covenant relationship that we have established with God. We sang the first song that was divinely selected by our song leader today was Nearer, Still Nearer, Close to Thy Heart, Draw Me, My Savior, So Precious Thou Art. Fold me, close to Thy breast, shelter me safe in Thy haven of rest. Shelter me safe in Thy haven of rest. It is a prayer asking for closeness with God. It is a prayer expressing a covenant relationship with Him. To be separated from the one that we love is about the worst thing that we could imagine. We desire this closeness. It's hard for us to imagine life without this relationship. We look in Scripture and we realize that at one time we were cut off. We were cut off from a relationship with God. We were not part of God's family. We were not adopted as children. We had not heard the blessed invitation to be God's children. Hard to imagine. For those of us who have been in this relationship for a while, we can't imagine what life was like before we established this relationship. It's part of who we are. But we have to realize that we cannot take that relationship for granted. With those words of introduction, I would like to ask our scripture reader for the day to lead us in our scripture reading.
Our scripture reading today is going to be from Acts 10. That's going to be 1 through 8, that's Acts 10, 1 through 8. And this is me as Paul, for Peter. At Caesarea, there was a man named Cornelius, the centurion, what was known as the Italian regiment. He and all his family were devoted Christians, fearing our God, praying men. He gave generously to those needed and prayed to God regularly. One day at 3 in the afternoon, he had a vision. He distinctly saw an angel of God who called him and said, Cornelius. Cornelius answered, What is it, Lord? He asked. The angel answered, Your prayers and gifts to the poor have come as a memorial offering before God. Now send men to Joppa to bring back a man named Simon, who is called Peter. He is staying with Simon the tanner, whose house is at by the sea. When I spoke to him had gone, Cornelius called two of his servants and a devoted soldier who was one of his attendants, and he told them everything that had happened and sent them to Joppa.
It's possibly easy for us to skip over the significance of this passage, which our brother Ashley read for us today. Before the Lord left to ascend to the right hand of the Father, he told his disciples to wait in Jerusalem for the gift that would be given to them. And sure enough, there they were, praying together on the day of Pentecost, people from many different regions from the area, different nations, different cities, different areas, and the Spirit came with power on those gathered in Jerusalem. They spoke different tongues, they spoke in different languages, tongues of fire appeared with them, God's Holy Spirit came upon them in a powerful way. Some thought, surely these people are drunk. But indeed they were not drunk. Peter stood up and explained the significance of these events. The Holy Spirit came on the people, beginning in Jerusalem. Now Jesus said, you will be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the earth. And week by week, as we've been going through the book of Acts, we've seen how that promise has been fulfilled. We see that promise beginning in the temple courts in Jerusalem. The Spirit comes first to the Jews. But then we see the Spirit crossing borders into the Samaritans. To the Samaritans. I mean, wow, the division had been significant. The Samaritans, I mean, they had a different border. They had a different temple to offer sacrifices in. They had a different heritage. They even read different books in the Holy Scriptures and didn't recognize the same books between the two nations. And Jews didn't hang out with Samaritans. They were far off. But God sent the Spirit even to the Samaritans. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria. We see that promise being fulfilled with Philip going to the Samaritans and we see that Philip is used not only to preach to somebody who had been a sorcerer, someone who had been called the great power of God, and even this man turned to God, an improbable person to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Simon the sorcerer now becomes Simon, the dearly loved, adopted child of God. He had a lot to learn. He still had to learn that the power of the Spirit couldn't be bought with money, and he got the appropriate rebuke for his mistaken conclusion. But then Simon answered, "Pray to the Lord for me that nothing you may say may happen." And indeed, we learn that the gospel continued to spread. As Philip was caught up, he ended going to a road going from Jerusalem to Gaza, and he preaches to the Ethiopian. He receives the adoption as a son of God coming out of the waters of baptism. It is then that Philip is taken away. The eunuch did not see him again, but went on his way rejoicing. Philip, however, appeared at Azotus and traveled about preaching the gospel in all of the towns until he reached Caesarea. So the gospel is spreading. The gospel is going to people who were at one time far off, cut off from the covenants, cut off from the good news, cut off from the grace of God. We find that hard to believe. Why would God cut anyone off? But he had established his covenant with Israel. He established the covenant which included ceremonial laws of what you eat and what you don't eat, who you associate with and who you don't associate with. There's were the covenants. Theirs was the temple. And even as the temple courts were divided into the Holy of Holies and increasing, well, you have the various courts, the court of the Gentiles, the court of women, the courts which only Jewish men could enter into, the courts when only the high priest could enter. So there were divisions. There was separation, and there was a separation between the people and God. Only once a year could the high priest come into the presence of God, and that with not without blood. He had to sacrifice not only for his own sins, not only for the people's sins, but also for his own sins, because he was not able to offer a perfect sacrifice. But with the coming of Christ, those dividing walls were torn down. Those dividing walls of hostility were taken down because of the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ offering himself on the cross, the perfect sacrifice, allowing us to come boldly into the throne of grace. We have some beautiful grounds here on the church. The church grounds are quite something. It's fun. Sometimes I check the mail and just up a few hundred yards or a couple hundred yards, whatever, not even 100 yards, a few feet that way. And I said, I think I'm just going to walk around the church building. And there's some nice things, and it's easy to walk by them. Those who built this church building and established the grounds, they paid attention to the aesthetic nature of this. There's some very beautiful, one of our guests a number of weeks ago had worked in some kind of, I don't know what you call the people who work with stone. I don't think it was a stonemason, but he saw the stone in front of the building, and he said, "Oh wow, that's marble!" And he was wondering what quarry, out of what quarry was that piece of marble hewn, and he was looking at all of those amazing patterns in there. And then you can walk, and there's another big rock out there. I don't know if it's marble. Some of you might know what it is. I don't think it's quartz. Maybe it's marble. I don't know. But it's a beautiful rock that has been taken from the earth. And we realize that we have been hewn. We have been taken. We have been carved. We have been brought to the, we have been formed. We were taken from the earth. One of the kids last week had a question for me and said, asking, how did God make us out of the ground? And I couldn't quite explain how he made us out of the ground, but the best I could come up with was, it's important for us to eat vitamins like iron and various other precious metals and so forth and so on, because the elements that our bodies are made of are the same elements that are in the ground. And think about it. The food we eat ultimately comes from the ground, and it's nurtured from the earth, or from the sky, from the water coming down onto the earth. And we are told that God formed Adam out of the dust of the earth, and that we will ultimately return to the dust. But how he created a new life, I don't know. I don't know how he did that. But we are formed in his image, and he felt it good for us, for him to have fellowship with us. We know that God exists in Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, but he still saw it fit to create us, to create men, to create women, that we could share his joy, and he desires us to come near to him in a covenant relationship. But how are we born? It's a mystery. How does this body of dust, this collection of chemicals, become a human being, a living human being? We don't know. As I walk around the grounds, as I turn the corner around that other rock up there, this week I noticed that there were these beautiful, and I don't know what they are, I don't know if they're crocuses or what, but beautiful little flowers, and they're scattered all over the place. Now, I was just thinking, whoever planted those didn't seem to plant them in a flower bed. And I thought, you know what? I think this was done by God. I think we're told, consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They do not toil, nor do they spin. But I say to you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If God so takes care of the flowers of the field, will he not also take care of you? Now, we know no flower comes except there be a seed. We know that no tree is planted except there be a seed, if there be an acorn, if there be some kind of way that will be planted. And so we see that God plants seed. He sows the word of God, and we see this happening throughout Acts. We see that the word, the Spirit, has come not only to the Jews in Jerusalem, not only to the region of Judea, not only to the Samaritans, but also to ultimately the ends of the earth, to the Ethiopians, and then to someone, Saul, that improbable person who would become a great messenger to the Gentiles, this ever-expanding kingdom. Saul, this man whom God had so richly gifted with knowledge that would benefit his task as apostle to the Gentiles. He was well acquainted with Greek literature. He was well acquainted with the Old Testament scriptures, so he could be a perfect bridge between the Jew and the Gentile. He went first to the synagogue, but as the Jewish, as those doors to preaching the gospel closed on him, he said, I will go to the Gentiles. And he focused on that mission that the Lord had so richly given him. That brings us to chapter 10, where Cornelius calls for Peter. And God, in his sovereignty, is now reaching out to Caesarea. Caesarea, a major Hellenistic port inhabited mostly by Gentiles. And I don't know what Caesarea would have been like, but a major city of military presence. We see the person spoken of here as being a centurion of the Italian regiment. We also learn that this man was a God-fearing man. He was somebody who was attracted to the God of Israel. Someone who gave generously to those in need and who prayed to God regularly. He was attracted to the God of Israel. He was not yet a child of God. He was not yet in a covenant relationship with God. But there was something about this God that drew him. He hadn't sealed the deal. He hadn't, shall we say, consummated his relationship with God in becoming a proselyte, in proceeding through circumcision. But he was still drawn to God. And God was drawing him to him. We see that one day at about 3 p.m, he receives a vision from God. He distinctly saw an angel from God who came to him and said, Cornelius. We see that as our brother read this morning, the angel explains that his prayers, Cornelius' prayers and gifts, had come up as a memorial offering before God. And he gave Cornelius instructions that they needed to bring back a man named Simon, who is called Peter. He's staying with Simon the tanner, whose house is by the sea. We already begin to see these walls starting to break down. Peter, this apostle of God, impulsive as he might be, imperfect, though certainly called by God, and undoubtedly, undeniably, a leader in the church of Jerusalem, but somebody who is undoubtedly growing in his understanding of God and his plan as well, to be willing to even set foot in the house of a tanner, someone who lives with and works with dead animals, and who smells of his profession most likely, and by his being in that house, Peter would have been unclean according to the ceremonial law. But indeed, Peter is called while staying in this man's house, and Peter has a vision, as did Cornelius. Verse 9, about noon the following day, as they were on their journey approaching the city, Peter went up on the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat. While the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven opened and something like a large sheet being let down to earth by its four corners. and it contained all kinds of four-footed animals as well as reptiles and birds. Then a voice told him, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." All these things that would have been ceremonially unclean, these things that Israel would have been forbidden to touch, now God is telling Peter in a vision, do not call unclean what God has made clean. It happened three times, which emphasized that this was important. This was something God was very eager for Peter to understand. In Roy's very good comments this morning at the table, we learned how our Lord had to repeat three times his message before he went through the cross. Three times he came back. So many things in Scripture happen in threes, and this is a significant thing. In the book of Acts, when a story is repeated multiple times throughout the narrative, we know it's something to pay attention to. Even as last week, we learned about the story of Saul's conversion. And that story is repeated three times in the book of Acts. So when we see something that is repeated multiple times, it's something that says, be aware, take heed. This is an important message. This is something that we need to know about. And indeed, for Peter, this was an important thing he needed to know. Do not call unclean what God has declared clean. There's so much that could be said about how God is expanding his kingdom in these chapters. And I do thank Frank for the excellent class that he has been teaching, opening up this wonderful book to us. It's an amazing book that shows us God's plan to include even us in his kingdom. I'm going to read a comment from one of the commentators that talked about Cornelius and how even before he received the Holy Spirit, there was something that was drawing him to God and his kingdom. This is from Alexander McLaren. He was a preacher, I believe, of the 19th century. This is what he says. He says, "It has often been discussed whether Cornelius was a proselyte or not. It matters very little. He was drawn to the Jews' religion, had adopted their hours of prayer, reverenced their God, had therefore cast off idolatry, gave alms to the people as acknowledgement that their God was his God, and cultivated habitual devotion, which he had diffused among his household, both slaves and soldiers. It is a beautiful picture of a soul feeling after a deeper knowledge of God, as a plant turns its half-opened flowers to the sun." So indeed, we see in Cornelius's response to God and in God's response to Cornelius. God noticed Cornelius's emerging faith in God, his emerging trust in God, his devotion to the path of God. And indeed, the Spirit of God came even on Cornelius. It's a wonderful lesson. It is a lesson to know that God does not show favoritism, whether Jew or Greek, whether slave or free, whether male or female. We are all made to drink of one spirit. God does not show partiality. We see that for a period of time, there was the ceremonial law. There was the observance of clean and unclean laws that was used to identify who the people of God were. For a period of time, the Jews were set apart as God's chosen people. But God promised that through Israel, God would bless the nations, that God's covenant would come even to the Gentiles. And I'd like to look at one more passage of Scripture, and this is from the Old Testament. Let's turn to Daniel chapter 1. Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself that way. Now God had caused the official to show favor and compassion on Daniel. But the official told Daniel, "I am afraid of my lord, the king, who has assigned your food and drink. Why should he see you are looking worse than the other men your age? The king would then have my head because of you." Daniel said to the guard, whom the chief official had appointed over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, "Please test your servants for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then compare our appearance with that of the young men who eat the royal food and treat your servants in accordance with what you are." So he agreed to this and tested him for 40 days. In this period of time, in the Old Testament, in what they called Second Temple Judaism, the observance of clean and unclean laws, we see that Daniel was determined not to defile himself with the king's food, but to observe the covenant commitment that the Lord had given them to do. It was an identity claim whereby the Jews were publicly set apart from the Gentiles. The amazing thing is that with the coming of the Lord, no longer was what was once considered unclean. But indeed, God called all things clean, and all foods were declared clean, and all nations were declared able to come to the Lord. Let us remember that God has been reaching out to us throughout the generations. He has sent his Spirit to us. He has sent his Word to us. It began with hello. It continued with consecration. It continued with communion. And it will ultimately end in consummation. Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you that you have called us by your voice. You have called us near to you. You have not cut us off, but you have welcomed us to your table. We thank you that you have done so. We thank you that your Spirit, that your Word was spoken to us. And we pray, O Lord, that we indeed may be continuously conformed to your likeness, living as your dearly loved children. Hear our prayer. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God longs for us to draw near to him. God longs for us to ask, and we shall receive. He says, "You do not have because you do not ask." And he says, "Do not be burdened. Do not be anxious about anything. but in everything through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, make your requests known unto God. And the prayers of your brothers and sisters are available to pray on your behalf. And the Lord says, come to me. If you are not a Christian and you need to establish your covenant relationship with him through baptism, the Lord is calling you. Whatever your need might be, please make it known as we stand and sing.